Hey folks, this is Abel James, and thanks so much for joining us on the Fat Burning Man Show, where we talk about real food and real results. Can you get more out of your workouts by doing less? Instead of redlining every time you train, you might get even better results by making your training less intense and your recovery longer. There's something to be said for practicing the state of ease. So returning to the show today is our friend Brad Kearns. No slouch, Brad is a world-ranked professional triathlete, Guinness World Record-setting professional speed golfer, podcast host, and New York Times best-selling author. If you're looking to improve your performance or enjoy your recovery, this show is for you. Before we get there, here's a note that came in from Bumcrick on Apple. 5 out of 5 stars. They say, thanks for the excellent program. This show has been an excellent companion for my personal fitness journey. Utilizing the concept of burning fat for fuel, intermittent fasting, and appropriate amounts of exercise, I have shed 50 pounds of excess fat. Also, I've improved my cardiovascular and liver function as well. Your guests and discussions help me stay focused and on track. I appreciate the show and wish you continued success. Hey, Bumcrick, thank you so much for dropping that kind review of this show. 50 pounds, speaking of no slouch, that is impressive. But even more important, improving your biomarkers like your cardiovascular and liver function. This stuff matters. Just to put it into perspective, 50 pounds is about the weight of one of my biggest tube amplifiers for my guitar. So I can't imagine having that off your back. Congratulations to you. And if you're out there and you want to support this show, please just drop us a quick review wherever you listen to this show, whether it's Apple, Spotify, or the video versions of this show. Always appreciate hearing from you. You can also email me directly over at fatburningman.com by replying to the newsletter, or just hit up Abel@fatburningman.com. I respond to as many as I can. But if you'd really like to get involved and level up your own game, then check out our new app, The Wild Challenge. We're going to be doing monthly challenges. We've already started off this year with a lot of momentum. We have hundreds and even thousands of people joining from all across the world in our multiple communities. But anyway, we're doing big giveaways. We've already sent out a few huggable bacon plushies, vitamin D from Wild Superfoods, our family company, as well as Omegas and other goodies. So right now you can sign up for our challenge and also the giveaways through the Wild Challenge app. All you have to do is go to fatburningman.com/app. That's fatburningman.com/app. And if you want to get half off entrance to the next Wild Challenge, you can enter the code during checkout, BWILD50. That's BEWILD50, all one word as the promo code. It'll get you 50% off your entrance to the next Wild Challenge. We're really excited about where we're going with this. Our communities are getting much more interactive. We have many, many, many more tools at our disposal. And of course, our giveaways are pretty awesome. So be sure to join in the fun over at fatburningman.com. You can always join our newsletter to stay up to date. We have lots of exciting announcements coming up soon. I'll see you over there. All right, on to this show with Brad Kearns. We're chatting about fueling for peak performance and not bonking, or at least not bonking too often. How practicing effortlessly can take you to the next level. If only I could say effortlessly, effortlessly. Not being a slave to the metronome or the treadmill in your training. The mental state change of breaking a sweat in just 5 minutes or less, and tons more. Let's go hang out with Brad. Welcome back, folks. Returning to the show today is Brad Kearns. Brad is a Guinness World Record-setting professional speed golfer, number one ranked USA age 55 to 59 high jumper, as well as former U.S. national champion and number three world-ranked professional triathlete. Brad, of course, is also host of the B-Rad podcast and a New York Times best-selling author of over 10 books, including the newly released title, right here, Two Meals a Day. Brad, welcome back, my friend.
Oh my gosh, Abel, I'm so happy to be back on the Fat Burning Man show. Often rated the number one show, but definitely, whatever the rankings are, up and down, you're in the top, but definitely the number one voice in the podcast world. I don't think anyone can dispute that.
Hey,
it helps with your high-tech equipment, but you got that smooth voice that was seasoned with hundreds of days a year on the road playing the tunes and now working the podcast scene. So yes, it's a true honor to be talking with you.
Crooning for two people at a time, hundreds or thousands of times over and over again, I guess, eventually turns out into something. So I appreciate being here. And once again, like I told you before we started recording, I need to compensate for my ridiculous hair now. So might as well just make sure I know how to turn the knobs. But I want to make sure that we talk to you about, you know, of course, the two meals a day principle. So let me play devil's advocate a little bit and let me ask you about why that might work.
Wow. Yeah, I love it. Well, as you know, and we're so deep into this game that we take a lot of assumptions for granted. But if we can simplify things, and I think that was one of the goals of this book, is to approach the everyday person who's busy living life and they don't feel like pricking their finger to test their ketones five times a day or use their app to zap everything they eat and you know, micromanage their diet. So we have to honor these big picture principles before we split hairs and discuss whether the carnivore diet is a fad or is it legit, and what's the pros and cons of the vegan plant-based versus the meat-heavy diet. And so all that stuff's great. And I mean, you have great content talking about that with the world's leading experts. So there's plenty of information out there. But I don't know about you, Abel, but I believe, you know, we engage with real-life, everyday folk all the time. And I'm thinking to my childhood buddies that I gather with regularly, and we share, and we're still connected. And, you know, they might ask me, like, hey, Brad, is this plate of nacho, is this healthy or not healthy? You know, tell me. Like in one word answer, please, yes or no. And so people are looking for simple solutions and to cut through all the hype and the controversy that we engage with and read the research about every single day. So I think that's, you know, you ask about the title, and that's a really nice starting point discussion to say, look, we need to choose the healthy foods and get rid of the junk food, and we need to eat less frequently. And if we achieve those two objectives, oh my gosh, we're going to be well down the road to health, like extremely far down that road. And then we can start taking some different forks and looking to bring back the six-pack abs that we're missing since we left the Dartmouth campus or whatever our story is right now, that we want to just take it a little bit higher.
Yeah. Now, of course, the two meals a day thing is awesome, I think, from a lifestyle perspective. It's something that I'm doing today, literally, have been doing for many years in various forms, but it's you know, one of those things that in the modern world, I see it as a way to manage all of these foods and ridiculous, you know, just stimuli coming at you all the time that we're not used to, that we have to like say no and say no and use up our willpower until eventually we're eating too much and bored and snacking too much and all these things. So we really need to have our defenses up, and simplifying things into two meals a day really helps make that a lot simpler and more manageable for most, like you said, like everyday people who aren't obsessive about diet and nutrition, like some of us might be.
Well, you know, the way you just said that, it's really important. And I think it's been nagging in my mind lately, because there's so many ways to optimize diet, but we have to put some rules and restrictions into place. And there's some great work, I'm sure you're familiar with, you know, like Dr. Guyanet's book, The Hungry Brain, or Rob Wolf's book, Wired to Eat. And so we're kind of circling into this conclusion that, yes, we are bombarded with hyper-palatable foods that we really love to eat, and we're prompted to consume more and more of for many reasons. One of them is that we're not active enough moving around every day. So we bring that lifestyle and that movement element into this book, because it's not just about food choices. But if you can't get some rules and restrictions into place, you're really going to suffer to the temptations and all that. So if you kind of have a pattern where, you know, the subtitle of this book should have been two meals a day and no snacking, because the snacking is now being identified as surprisingly destructive to your fat burning and your fat reduction goals. Every time you snack on anything, even if it's super healthy, you immediately shut off fat burning and you process the calories that you just consumed. So if we can kind of tighten up our experience to eating delicious, nutritious meals that really satisfy us. And that's why I always like, I don't love commercials, but I like hearing the commercials for the Wild Diet, because it's always about the taste of the food and the experience of cooking and all these cool things. And I'm like, yeah, man, that's right. I'm going to have the most spectacular, satisfying meals, not worry about my portion size or overstress these things, but always feel satisfied and enjoy the experience of eating. And then certainly we can get away with, you know, a maximum of two meals a day, sometimes less if we're busy and maybe we're just having a half a meal at a certain point, and then we know we're going to have a big celebratory dinner that evening.
Yeah, and it's important to know how to partition that over time, and you'll kind of have to learn how to get the hang of that for yourself. But I'm curious for you, especially because you've been a peak athlete for so many years in so many different domains, how do you reconcile eating less with peak performance? Because I know from where you're coming from, and Mark Sisson, of course, talks about just going through everything possible in terms of calories, just trying to increase your caloric load as much as possible, like Michael Phelps might.
Yeah, that's really weird. I'm sure you're familiar with this new book by Dr. Herman Ponser called Burn, where he references his study of the Hadza that's highly respected. It's been going on for a decade. And some of these insights are just truly mind-blowing. One of them is that we burn around the same number of calories every day, regardless of our activity level. And so the extreme calorie burning athletes, Michael Phelps, or back in my day when I was training 4 or 5 hours a day to compete on the pro triathlon circuit, what happens when you have that extreme energy output, like a CrossFit Games person or someone going for the ultra run and putting in their 80 to 100 mile weeks, what happens is you start to compromise these other important essential human functions like immune function, repair, growth, reproductive fitness. And so we start to drop off and become a less healthy human because we insist on running so many miles and miles each day, and it's unsustainable, it's unhealthy. So we really are trying to find a sweet spot of optimizing our activity level, not being extreme and overdoing it. Oh, by the way, when you're extreme and overdo it, what happens to your appetite hormones? They get totally thrown out of whack to the extent that you eat not only enough food to replace your glycogen and the calories that you burned, but a little bit more. And Mark Sisson's quote is great. He says, the reason you eat too much is because the brain is saying, what if this fool tries to do this again tomorrow? I better stuff my face again.
Right.
And so that's what's happening inside metabolically, and the brain, the control tower for a decision of how much to eat and when we feel satisfied and all that, it gets thrown out of whack with overly stressful lifestyle. So overly stressful, too much exercise, that's one of them. And then there's all kinds of other ways to get to that overstress pattern where you're overeating.
Yeah, but to your point of sacrificing other systems, I remember when I was training for marathons, and even though I was young and in my 20s and should have been peak health, like especially at first before I really knew much of what I was doing, I would get sick hard every time within hours of coming home, within hours of sitting down and being done with my run, or which was usually, you know, 20, 30 miles or so. I would just be finished for at least 3 days, sometimes a whole week. My immune system would be done. I'm sure you're familiar with that phenomenon.
Yeah. And then you also, I love your story. One of my favorite single web pages is the Meet Abel or About Abel or something. Yeah. And you're talking about not only were you toast for real life activities, but you didn't even have the fat burning man six pack. You couldn't even get the fat off your body despite running for 30 miles. So what the hell's going on there? It was not feeling great and overeating and just messing up the whole equation. It's not that hard. So we're trying to kind of back off from any of this extreme stuff.
Let's get a little more into the weeds, though, with refueling glycogen in particular and not bonking. Because anyone who's been there or close knows that that's a something you would hope to be a once-in-a-lifetime experience or less, right? So how do you make sure that you're fueled but also not overfuel? Because that is it's a tough balance sometimes.
Yeah, I don't know if that's it's kind of fun. I think everyone should experience that once as a bucket list.
Yeah, like maybe once, but
just know what it's like to bonk. And I remember reading this in Dave Scott, the triathlete's book. He claims that he can ingest a fig and in a matter of 5 seconds experience a boost in his mental alertness and his performance when he's, wow, you know, getting near the thing. And if you've ever bonked and then have your first input of Skittles from the convenience store that you finally get to on your bike ride, it's pretty awesome to see what it feels like hitting bottom. And now, you know, this interesting research about being a fat adapted athlete and a fat adapted person is that we can reload glycogen through internal mechanisms, even if we don't stuff our face with carbohydrates. The FASTER study that was ran by Dr. Volek, this was amazing because they depleted these guys. They ran for 3 hours on a treadmill with their needles poking in them and the mask on their face. And then the low carb group, the guys that were already adapted to their lifestyle of eating low carb, like Zach Bitter, Ben Greenfield, people were in the study. Overnight, they restocked glycogen. And it was from perhaps the splitting of the glycerol molecule off of the triglyceride because they were eating a high fat diet. And so this obsession with stuffing our face with carbs because we're an athlete can easily be repurposed. But I would rather even speak to a bigger picture than that, which is if you're depleting your glycogen over and over again from these crazy workouts, this is not a path to fitness nor health. And so, you know, once in a while, you're going to do a crazy glycogen depleting workout, like a whatever, the big CrossFit workout of the month, where you're really going to push yourself for 60 minutes straight of, you know, high intensity exercise. Or if you're a long distance person, yeah, we're going to go long on Saturday the 18th, and we're going to go for 4 hours, and that's going to be a big dog. But then, you know, the ensuing 7, 8, 9 days, you're going to be kind of balancing that stress and not needing to overfeed yourself.
And sometimes you need to shut yourself down a little bit, right? I remember last time I had you on the podcast, we talked about not going on a run sometimes, you know, or going for the short one instead of just like pushing it and pushing it. So let's talk about maybe a little bit on the benefits. I think most of us are familiar with some of them, but mostly how to do that. How do you mentally do the acrobatics that some of us need to do in order to get in that headspace?
Yeah, boy, I love your questions. They're really taking us into maybe places that we don't think about enough. And one of those things that I realized after coaching athletes for a long time, as well as dealing with my own, you know, emotional insecurities and human frailties and decision-making processes where I made mistakes when I was a professional competitor and suffered on the race course because of overtraining patterns, you have to sit back and think, you know, what am I really doing this for? And are these athletic or fitness goals aligned with my health, aligned with the pursuit of things like longevity? Or am I just using this as a release valve to other forms of stress in my life where I have to go and burn energy out on the road because my job is so stressful? And I think a lot of people, you know, you were talking about a type A population in general anyway, the people that are listening and concerned if they're exercising too much or not. Yeah. Some people listening, I don't know about this show, but maybe some of your listeners are sitting on the couch going, dang, when am I going to start turning into the fat burning man?
Right, if only that were my problem.
Okay. Right. So many of us need to exercise more. Almost all of us need to move more, especially athletes, because athletes take the hall pass and they sit around all day. In between their hour-long workouts every morning when they're 6 a.m. at the spin class at the gym, and then they sit around for the rest of the day, and that's not healthy either. So to find that fine line, you know, first we look at our values and our biggest purpose. And so when I was an athlete, this was my career. So my stated purpose was to be the best athlete I could. So if I needed to rest, I had a much easier time making that decision than maybe the next person who was just out there to burn off steam or has been falsely indoctrinated to the idea that you have to burn calories every day or you're gonna get fat. That's because your diet sucks. It's not because you missed a day of running.
Yeah. What about, you know, when you really are on the edge and you could put in those extra miles and go the long way home, right? But you know you shouldn't. How do you say no to that? Personally, I'm curious.
You know, for me, what it's all about is I want to perform better and I want to, you know, achieve my competitive goals. So it's not just about being a slave to my training log and achieving an outlet for my ego demands. And that is a that's a big one where you got to look in the mirror, because I've had those times in my life where I'm cruising down the beach bicycle path on a recovery workout and looking at my heart rate monitor, and I'm in the right zone, just taking it easy. And then some doofus passes by me wearing tennis shoes, and he's got a bodybuilding outfit on with fake bicycle shorts, and he blows right by me, "On your left," you know, and I'm like, "You know what, dude? You picked the wrong guy. I'm ranked seventh in the world right now and moving up to ultimately becoming third." And so, you know, giving chase to your ego as well as the person who just passed you on the bike path, that's where you have, you know, showed your true cards, and this is what matters most to you. And I remember talking about this with this guy I used to train with once in a while. He was an older guy, and he was extremely fit, and he could ride with guys who, like me, who are on the pro circuit. And I'm like, "Warren, do you ever compete? I mean, that was an incredible climb. You stayed right with us." He goes, "No, I don't compete in, you know, formal events. I just like to beat up on my training partners during workouts." And so, you know, that day for him was a race, and he hung with some, you know, high level athletes on a climb, which was a routine training day for us. But I was very impressed with this guy, and also with his, you know, directness that, "No, this is what I'm all about, is competing on a day-to-day basis during workouts." So yeah. if that's your game, that's fantastic. You can't judge that. But if you're going to tell me in a coaching questionnaire, "I want to be a role model for my children and pursue the great goal of competing in the Hawaii Ironman someday," okay, well, then don't go out there for a jog when your fever is 101 degrees and you have, you know, aches and pains, but you think you're honoring this esteemed athletic goal. And so once we get the mindset right, then it's super easy to make decisions, because if you don't feel like heading out the door one day, it's kind of like, you know, if you're a musician and you don't feel like practicing one day, that means you should probably take that day off, because if you love it deep in your heart and you love to do it, but it doesn't feel right, something feels wrong, that's a powerful sign that, you know, you don't need to get out there and overcome your weak mindset, which is, you know, extremely rare in high-performing community.
Yeah, and there are many parallels. In fact, I recently had a dream about my metronome ran out of batteries and like the stress around that. And I'm just like trying to deconstruct that. Does that mean I'm too stressed about following the strict time on the metronome? You know, which you can easily. And this happens to a lot of people who go to conservatory, music school, a lot of friends and peers of mine, this happened to in the arts, where you just go too deep into the purely skill-based stuff, the mechanics of it. And sometimes at the sacrifice of the spirit at all. That's where you get writer's block, right? Because you've just been playing to a metronome soullessly for years in a room without windows, you know, sucking on stale air. And I think a lot of athletes are already, they're there, you know, with their own athletics. They just don't quite realize it. Sometimes you have to take a step back and it's only then that you realize what you've been up to and how it's not really serving you or the people around you. Sometimes, like you said, your family.
You're just honoring the metronome, man. Get off
Don't
the treadmill.
Don't be a slave to the metronome, though. Don't be a slave.
I remember, when I was a young college runner and, you know, battling injuries and trying so hard to keep up with the team and, you know, pushing myself too hard. And I was out for a run one day at beautiful UC Santa Barbara campus. And I was on the, you know, the main trail that goes away from the campus to the dorms. And I came upon this slower runner. And as I got within 20 yards, every step that he took, the definition of his calf muscles was unbelievable. It's like nothing I'd ever seen. Like the guy was just a thoroughbred racehorse, Rip City, running super slow on the jogging trail at UCSB. And so I said, you know, "On your left." And then I pass by him and give him a little nod. And I look and I'm like, I slow down. I said, "Are you Dr. Tomas?" And he goes, "Yes, I am." And this was the German middle distance runner, Tomas Vesinghaga. At that time, he was the number three in the history of the world in the 5,000 meters. So he was a world-class Olympic athlete. And here he was running on my jogging trail to the dorms. And so I said, a couple questions, you know, what are you doing here? And why are you running so slowly, if you don't mind me asking? And he says, "Oh, I'm here on a training camp. I'm doing some medical." He was also a doctor. He was doing some medical work and this and that. And he goes, "The reason I'm running slowly is because when it's time for me to run fast, I run fast. And when it's time to be slow and take care of the body, I run slow. So here is the, you know, the world's leading runner, you know, doing 9 minute plus per mile pace. And I'm thinking that I need to push myself harder on my recovery days to make sure that they're worthwhile. And so that was a real, you know, you get enough of those insights over time. And I used to, you know, I got to hang around with the very best athletes in the world in triathlon. And sometimes, you know, we'd go to the swimming pool to do the big workout and we'd get there and sit on the lounge chairs for a bit. And it would be like, you know what? I'm not feeling it today. I'm going to pass, even though I'm totally focused on the championship race coming up. But you just get these intuitive signs. And then as you start to listen to your intuition more and more, and you get that payoff on the race course of like, wow, that race was easy and I beat everybody because I've been taking better care of myself and not killing myself in training. Then you get validation for a kinder, gentler approach and taking better care of yourself and being kinder to yourself.
Yeah, and it's so interesting that you share that advice from some of the best athletes, because it's super similar for some of the most technical, virtuosic musicians who say you have to play slow in order to play fast. And so you have to play everything extremely slowly in order to get everything down first before you can play extremely fast. And it's just, I love the parallels between running, especially, and athletics and practicing scales on instruments, because it really, tendonitis is the same when you run into it, you know what I mean? And you have to, another piece of this that came up while you were saying that was you have to practice it being effortless. You have to practice it being easy, right? So in running super fast, redlining it, gunning it every time, you're practicing being in a state of stress and it being really hard. When you're running really slowly and it's super easy, like the time that you're putting in, your brain is making these connections saying, oh, this is easy. And then you can bring that effortlessness to that next level if you've put in the work and the chops and the recovery and all the rest of that. So anyway, I thought that was really interesting.
Yeah, that's an interesting parallel. I'm reminded of Eliud Kipchoge. He's the greatest marathon runner of all time from Kenya. He's active right now. He's the guy that just broke the 2-hour marathon on that special event and Olympic champion. And, you know, go try to run a 4:38 mile, or try to run a quarter of a mile at that pace that he kept for 26 miles. It's one of the most superhuman achievements ever. But interestingly, he published his training log and all the intimate details on the internet for everyone to read, which is kind of rare for an elite athlete. And the exercise physiologist went to town and did some calculations based on his race pace to his training pace. And the pull-away insight was, this guy trains well within himself at all times. So he's never toasting himself with a crazy giant week where he has to, you know, crash on the couch and he's barely hanging on. He's always running at a pretty high speed because he's the greatest runner ever. But for him, he feels comfortable. He's working hard, but not too hard. And so if we can all take that insight and apply it to our own training schedule, guess what that means?
Yeah.
It means that most of your efforts are going to be a freaking jog walk, because that's your 70% or your 65% of max capacity level, which is what this guy's doing almost all the time. And he might blow by you if you see him on the road one day in Eldoret, Kenya. He's running, you know, a 5:40 pace per mile at high altitude, and that's his easy day, but that has no relevance to you. And so your easy day is going to be a 30-minute jog walk. And that part, you know, we would rather, I mean, it's kind of going back to your early question that I try to answer questions, Abel, but sometimes they go trail off
onto a
thing. Yeah. But, you know, you ask like, how do you regulate that? And, boy, it's not easy because our ego's in the way and we kind of want to, you know, achieve something that we can feel good about and get that instant gratification. And then when we're talking about the gym community, where you're going into a spinning class and your teacher, or you turn on the Peloton screen, I want some peppy instructor. I want to get my money's worth, my $30 a month or whatever. And I want her telling me to go sprint the last few hills of the Tour de France. I don't want someone going, take a deep breath, release the stress of your day. You know, that's not what we go for in the gym, but that might be the best thing that we need and deserve at that time. But then that means we have to kind of turn off this addiction to the endorphin high and use exercise as a way of truly de-stressing rather than just energy expenditure all the time. It's like a one-dimensional approach to fitness.
Yeah, and it really doesn't take much in order to cycle all that cortisol through your system and to get into a different physiological state and mental state. You know, even just a few minutes, breaking a sweat less than 5 minutes can do it. I think like 20 to 40 minutes is pretty good. But at the same time, I like to work out sometimes if I'm doing a walk, hike, sprint combo thing. Sometimes an hour and a half, 2 hours on those longer days, like you said. And those feel really good sometimes, but only at the right time. Those days when you're really forcing it and trying to hammer everything into place aren't the days to do that, in my experience. It'll come back to bite you.
Yeah, that's right. And what's interesting is like we have this regimented approach to training, which is so common, and it's you know, propagated by the magazines and the books and the videos and whatever. Like, here's your 8-week training program to complete the upcoming marathon. And
hustle like every day.
Yeah, right. And it's like, do this this day, do this the next day, like you're a robot. But the human is so dynamic and there's so many other variables. And the best, you know, the best choice, I think, the most highest level of sophistication of a training program is that completely intuitive approach where you head out into the forest and maybe you head out 6 days in a row. And on one of those days, you're going to feel like going for an hour and a half, 2 hours and really pushing it. But it just feels natural. And it's like the most beautiful happening that you did it right at the right time. And then the other days, you just kind of let the feelings sink in and sometimes decide to turn around after 12 minutes because you got too much on your mind or your knee is still sore or whatever. And if we could just do that, and we're all very, very good at that, we have a wonderful intuitive sense of how to live life. We just ignore it or have these shouting voices on our shoulder that emanate from flawed childhood programming that are, you know, sending these messages to the subconscious. You're not good enough. You're lazy. You're this. And so we override the intuition. In an effort to like repeat these cycles of, you know, flawed behavior patterns, really.
So what does rest and recovery look like? Is it pretty active? Are you doing lots of rolling and making sure your fascia is in good shape and all the rest of that? Or is it just laying out on the couch like some people think it is?
Yeah, interesting. I mean, you know, I competed a long time ago and we thought the ultimate expression of rest and recovery was on the couch, go to the video store. Now you can tell how long ago I competed. They used to have video stores. You young listeners, take note. You could go in and get these things called a VHS tape, and I'd go in and get a stack of them and come home and eat a lot of food and put my legs up, and that was like, how can you top that?
Yeah.
And now, you know, the emerging exercise science is revealing that there are ways to actually improve recovery, speed recovery through properly conducted recovery-based workouts. There's a guy in Washington, Joel Jamison. He trains MMA fighters. He's got a website called 8weeksout.com. And he created this thing called a rebound workout. And he's a big leader in HRV testing. He's been doing it for a couple decades. Now we can all get the watch on and track our HRV. And he can get a boost in HRV, which is a positive thing, meaning you're more rested, from a specially designed workout, which includes breathing exercises, foam rolling, dynamic stretching, and then, interestingly, doing very short bursts of explosive effort, even when you're tired, okay, and no impact. So let's say you're a big runner, you did your track workout, and now you're in the gym the next day. So you get on an exercise bike, and let's say sprint for 6 seconds, and then take a really long recovery period. And during the recovery period, you make a huge focused intention to lower your heart rate. So let's say you're looking at the screen, you're looking at your watch, and you're thinking lower heart rate, lower heart rate, lower heart rate. And if you can build that skill to burst yourself with a fight or flight burst of effort, and then teach yourself to lower that heart rate. You can do that during a stressful moment at work. You can do it as you're about to approach an argument with a loved one. And the net effect of a workout like that is you get a spike in parasympathetic, the rest and digest element of the nervous system. And that'll help speed recovery because the body likes to rebound after a brief burst of high intensity effort. The problem is when we do the workout, the hard workout, we're doing 30 sprints of 10 seconds and we're only resting 20 or 30 seconds after. And the whole thing turns, it kind of goes over this curve of optimal stress into overstress. And boy, a little goes a long way, especially when it comes to high intensity. And I'm learning that myself. Oh my gosh, this guy, Dr. Craig Marker, he writes at breakingmuscle.com, and he wrote this transformative article called HIIT versus HURT. And we all familiar with HIIT is high intensity interval training, very popular training modality. And his take on it, he calls it high intensity repeat training. In other words, you want to repeat explosive efforts in a manner at which the quality stays consistent throughout the workout. So when I go sprint, I'll do 6 times 80 meters of full sprint. And the first one is just as good as the last one. Maybe the last one's better because I'm warmed up and all that, but there's no attrition in performance, which we're so accustomed to seeing when we're doing a killer interval workout that the Peloton class calls for, or the spinning class or the boot camp, where, you know, the last 10 minutes, the teacher's like, come on, suck it up, guys. You're almost there. We're almost to the finish line. Okay, one more set of crazy ass whatevers, and you're just exhausted at the end. So you're glycogen depleted, you're buzzing and overproducing production of stress hormones, you're going to be sitting on the couch the rest of the day, and you're going to be reaching for Ben and Jerry's that night because of the depleting effects of the workout. In contrast, the workout I describe, where I'm doing these sprints that are of equal quality, I'm also taking an extensive amount of rest in between each one, because I'm there to do a sprint workout. I'm not there to do a suffer workout or a suffer fest, which once in a while there's a time and a place for athletes to try to approximate the race challenge. But in this case, I'm doing the sprint, I'm resting and feeling super comfortable when I toe the line for the next one. So the next one's awesome. I rest again. So I'm not, you know, kind of accumulating fatigue during the workout. And then best of all, I walk away from the track and I still have a little bounce in my step. I worked really hard. I had a tremendous maximum output during these efforts, but I'm not toasted by it. And, you know, back to your long runs. It's like if you had conducted those runs at a much, much slower pace, they arguably would have been tremendously beneficial. You wouldn't have gotten sick. You wouldn't have been super tired after. You would have just been building very carefully to becoming a true endurance machine. But maybe at that time in that place, it really meant a jog walk instead of a 7-minute pace or whatever you were trying. You know, you were reaching to try to achieve some arbitrary goal.
Yeah, and a similar thing with the high intensity interval training type workouts, which I like to do hill sprints often here, but we're at altitude. I run from 8,000 up to 9 or 10, and it's pretty steep grades. And so at first I was trying to do more like the Tabata style with the short rest, you know, like 10 times or whatever. You're just going all out for 20, 30 seconds. Then you're taking a very short rest, you know, 10, 20 seconds, maybe 30 seconds max, and then gunning it again. And contrast that to what I've been doing for the past like year or two, which is almost as much rest as I want after each explosive run, which can now be more like 25 or 30 seconds, even up those grades. So I can go a little longer, harder, and faster, but then I have to wait 2, 3, maybe even 5 minutes. I wear my watch and I'm waiting for my heart rate to come back down. But to your point, you're practicing your heart rate recovery. You're practicing coming back down. And a lot of people never practice that because that's harder to practice. It takes a lot of self-discipline to be doing something while not doing something, right? That like active rest seems like wasted time, but maybe the most important time of your actual workout.
Right. And the heart doesn't lie. So it's not like, you know, you need to toughen up and cut your rest down. You need to honor that I'm going to repeat the next effort when my heart rate drops into the predetermined zone to indicate that my body's recovered. I also can monitor like respiration level. And so I want to feel like my breathing's near back to normal. The heart rate's not going to drop down to your resting heart rate. We know that it's never going to come back until you're in the shower. But if you can kind of say, hey, I'm going to get it down to, you know, whatever your target number is, your breathing feels good. And then your mind is ready and optimized for another effort. There's a physiologist named Dr. Bompa, and he says, you want that central nervous system to be optimally excited and uninhibited. And so you see the sprinters in the starting blocks for the Olympics, and they're jumping up and down like crazy and doing like these mini jumping jacks and bouncing and moving. And even the basketball players during the national anthem, they're bobbing their neck back and forth and they're swinging their hips. And so they're getting into this competitive mode where they're ready to unleash like the panther striking for the prey. And that's how we want to feel before we do our next interval on the stationary bike in during our home workout or when you're out there in the hills of Colorado. And boy, it's a magical feeling when you can really tap into what it should feel like to be a high-performing athlete rather than just Mr. or Ms. Sufferfest, where you can come home and write a big number in your training log. Huge difference.
It's so funny too, because it's more like training like a kid. If I remember what it was like to play with my friends, it's like, you go all out. And then you just like hang out for a minute and like make jokes or whatever. Then you go all out and then you make jokes. And that is just, it's more fun, you know, to comment on my Sufferfest, you know, trying to do all of those intervals quickly, especially up the hills at altitude with the sun beating down. It's miserable. You know, that was kind of the point, just to see what that was like and see if that was worth it. And it's not really. It's really not. You know, from a quality of life standpoint and the way you feel when you get back home, put your rest intervals in. Those rest intervals, especially some of it too, is probably I'm getting into my late 30s now compared to training in my 20s, a different deal. And you need to make those accommodations. Maybe that's another place we can go next. How do you kind of like change your own goal line appropriately, and especially make sure that you don't get seriously hurt?
Yeah. Oh, don't go there. Don't go there. Aging. Oh, mercy. Yeah. It's been really fun for me to, pursue peak performance with tremendous passion throughout my life. But the changes in the approach are profound. And I think it's really nice to have that phase of life when we're youth and we can really go for it and go to the most extreme in pursuit of, you know, excellence, I guess, in whatever it is, academics or the arts or athletics or what have you. And so I had this 9-year block of my life where I was totally devoted to being the best triathlete I could be and spend hours and hours training. I spent half of my life asleep during my career on the pro circuit. I was sleeping 10 hours every night and a 2-hour nap without fail every afternoon. And if I missed my nap, if I only got an hour because I had to wait in line at the DMV, I was a little cranky and my swim workout wasn't as good. So I was like a sleep machine and a forward moving energy burning machine. But then you have to move on and go into the next healthy phase of life. And I remember, you know, raising kids and being a participatory coach. So I was really excited about dominating these poor little kids in soccer or basketball or track and field. I was like the coach who always threw down and brought the competitive intensity to practice. And that was really fun. And then that phase ended when they got bigger than me and started kicking my butt off the basketball court. So I had to go find my own nuanced competitive goals, like the speed golf record. And I love high jumping now and sprinting and things like that. But, you know, they have to be aligned with your overall lifestyle circumstances. So it's a nice, comfortable fit. And I really think it's a great idea that your fitness goals are aligned with longevity. I mean, that's kind of one of the main reasons we're out there, is to enjoy and use the body for as long as possible. And so that takes some thinking, revising, problem solving. Everyone says how recovery is delayed when we get older. And I always like to scoff at that and, you know, say age is just a number and things like that out of my mouth. And then I start reflecting further. And I think someone challenged me one time and they said, you know, age isn't just a number. And if you think that, you're an idiot. You need to, look at that age number. Okay, I'm 56 right now. And that's a very important number to me. And I'm going to have to honor that chronology in many ways and make the adjustments and listen to my body. And that's when I can make the best for my chronological number and render it mostly irrelevant to the aging process. So it's a more nuanced look than just saying, yeah, whatever. I'm young at heart, so that makes me young. Well, why don't you go train with those young guys and they'll kick your ass from here to, you know, Canada. And then you can come back and we can have a responsible conversation. So I'm trying to keep this edge going, Abel, so that I can have these competitive goals that mean so much to me, but also pursue them in an appropriate manner. So when I go and climb over the fence and sneak into the high school athletic facility to practice my high jump and I clear the bar that I've been, you know, I have a great result, I scream for joy when I'm on that pad And it's just like I won the national championships on ESPN and got a big giant check at the award ceremony and was, you know, the most frenetic energy of my life. But it means the same to me inside because I've worked so hard. I'm serious about it. I care a lot. But again, I'm by myself in an empty high school deserted stadium. So I'm keeping things in healthy perspective. I'm not, you know, talking down to the clerk at the grocery store when I go and shop for food after my workout. And so to keep that healthy perspective at all times is really important. So if you have a bad day and you're a busy executive, parent, you know, family person, and you have a bad workout, you know, just smile your way to the next opportunity instead of getting emotional and getting kind of frenzied about, you know, needing to be perfect with your fitness goals. I think that's a big thing I see too. Is like, come on, man, tone it down. You're just a recreational athlete.
Yeah. So when you're looking for your next obsession or your next sport or your next thing, is there a process you go through? Does that just come intuitively or accidentally? How does that work?
Oh my gosh. I'm glad I'm answering you because the next person might not understand, but I know you're going to connect with me here because it is so strange. And the whims that I follow are completely inexplicable, but all of a sudden I'll become consumed with like this crazy sport of high jumping. And I'm not a genetically a optimal high jumper from, you know, back in the day. I'm not 7 feet tall or whatever. I was an endurance athlete, but I've always loved the complexity of the event. And despite my genetic limitations, I'm out there practicing hard. And I have a coach that I hired. He's a former Russian Olympic triple jumper.
No
way. And he's super strict. And he's so hilarious because, you know, the American coaching style and personal training style is like, Abel, you're doing great, man. You look good.
Yeah.
Do another rep. Oh yeah. Solid workout. High five, you know. And this guy, you know, I met him the first time and like 2 minutes into the conversation, we're talking about my high jumping, this and that. And he says, so are you planning to reduce your weight? And I'm like, what did you just ask me? What did you say, fool? Because I'm, you know, I'm on the cover of books and internet courses and whatever. But he goes, no, you know, you should reduce your weight a little bit. You'll jump higher. And I'm like, well, F and A. Okay, I'm going to then. And then, you know, he'll give me a technique tip and then I'll go execute it. And I'll finish and I'll say, oh, my gosh, that does feel so much more explosive. Yeah. And he's shaking his head. He's going, no, you did not do it. You try it again. I'm like, okay, well, I thought I did. Does that matter? No, it doesn't matter, man. He's just there trying to get me better.
Yeah.
And so to have that type of experience, even as an old guy goofing around, it kind of brings in that level of passion, which I think we're trying to get to. And so, you know, you can take your goals seriously and be really, you know, disciplined about them, but at the same time, enjoy the experience and have a laugh here and there. And if you're don't, you know, reach your highest goal, the process is what, you know, is what it's all about, really.
Yeah. What about, especially in athletics and the high jump, how do you make sure you're not practicing mistakes for something that's super technical?
Yeah, that's brutal, man. I mean, how do I make sure? I hired this fool to come out and destructive criticism. But I remember when I was teaching swimming to triathletes, and their strokes were so terrible. I mean, the adult swimmer is like, you know, they're just trying to stay above water rather than move through the water gracefully like a collegiate swimmer. And, you know, sometimes I'd say, look, you really shouldn't be practicing without correcting these techniques. So I want you to swim back to what you said, very, very slowly, and think about nothing except your stroke. I do not want you to get a workout in the swimming pool. In other words, breathing hard and going for the clock and doing the things that these master swimming groups do where they're trying to give you a cardiovascular training effect. I'm like, look, swimmer, you already have an A+ in cardio because you're running like crazy and pedaling your bicycle up high mountains. You just need to get your technique right. So in technique-dependent sports, it's super, super important to be very precise and get constant critical feedback from outside reference. I have this video on YouTube. It's one of my goals in life, Abel. I got a viral video on YouTube. We got over a million views.
No way.
And it's called Brad Kearns Running Technique Instruction. And it was just me and my cameraman buddy. You probably met him, Brian. And we were just fooling around in the park in Portland one afternoon. I said, I want to show these guys some technique drills. And so let's film this. And it was like, I mean, my legacy to the planet is this goofy video. But I learned from Olympic runner Michael Stember that there are precise running technique attributes that I didn't even pay attention to because I'm a lifelong runner. I know how to run. My form's fine. It's not a technique-dependent event like swimming. But when you break it down and you want to achieve maximum propulsive force every time your foot hits the ground and takes another stride, even if you're jogging, boy, it opens up a whole new world. So I think people will love that video. And now, like I teach kids this too, like soccer teams, track teams, and I walk away from the lesson, I say, now there's no turning back for the rest of your life because now you know how to run correctly. And when you're lazy and not paying attention, you have to snap back into correct technique, even when you're doing something so simple as jogging. And so it's kind of like a breakthrough to, you know, the instruments upside down and left and right. And it's second nature to you. But at some point, someone corrected your finger position.
Absolutely.
So you
still
had to
now.
Think about it every single time. And it's still like, boom, there I am. Now I'm locked in. But if your mind wanders, you got to bring it back, bring it back. It's really fun, too. I think that's a fun part of all sports, golf especially, all that stuff.
As long as you're honest about it and you're willing to take feedback, which is hard as an adult, even for me, like when I first started retaking music lessons as an adult for the first time since like college, essentially, it was hard to like take feedback. Because like you said, sometimes it comes from a kind of like harsh, just matter of fact voice. Like, no, you did it wrong. Like, that's bad. You did it poorly.
Yeah. maybe you should reduce your weight, Abel. That would help
right,
you.
Exactly.
What are you talking about? Yeah, man.
But yeah, it is like that, and you need to be honest about it. But absolutely, one of the life-changing things for me was actually learning running form and the mechanics of running so that you bounce instead of smash, you know, and changing where, you know, the placement of the foot. And I had to relearn how to run with minimalist footwear and running barefoot time. This was around the same time I found Mark Sisson, you know, and all of that community, which is an amazing thing to share for a lot of people. But the shin splints, the IT band problems, and so many things that would just make me stop running because of injury, most of those just cleared up as soon as I got serious about learning proper technique, which meant hiring someone else to take video of me running and looking at it frame by frame, be like, nope, you did it wrong. That's bad. Don't do that. But it's so important to go through that process if you're serious about getting better and not getting hurt.
Yeah, I think it's more fun, you know?
Yeah, like, it is.
Why do something half-ass where, you know, I don't need a lesson. I'm just playing golf recreationally. Well, do you want to throw your back out or do you want to have a little more fun? Get a freaking lesson. You know, it's not a big deal. And I think people that dedicate their lives to teaching, especially the arts and activities, it's so cool because, you know, it's such a great gift to transfer to someone else that, you know, here's how to do this thing correctly. Now go enjoy it the rest of your life.
Yeah. And also just sharing the passion for the craft, which is, that's why I ask you about practicing mistakes, because I'm practicing mistakes all day accidentally, just kind of you're pushing yourself there. That's part of practicing whatever it is you want to get better at, is pushing it to the edge sometimes, making a mistake, but you want to make sure that you're not practicing the mistake part.
Oof, yeah. And we're so, I don't know why. Like, I think it's that classic joke that the man won't ask for directions at the gas station.
Yeah.
And now we don't have to because we have GPS. But it's like somewhere your ego gets involved and you kind of just have to let go and put yourself at the hands of the expert and trust them. And that's a nice exercise, too, to kind of step out of your zone. And I remember coaching a lot of triathletes. You know, it's like attracts a high income, highly successful population. And so these guys are like leaders of their world in the business high rise tower where they're given orders all day. And then I'm saying, look, your stroke is so that you shouldn't even practice swimming until you beat your stroke. And it's not always, you know, it's not always received perfectly well. But this is, you know, this is it. And in fact, I should say, like, the real high-performing, highly successful people have this attribute that they're open to feedback, even though they're the smartest person I know asks me more questions than the next person that has the what is it called? The arrogance bias, Dr. Ponser calls it. So the arrogance bias is a real thing. And the more arrogant you are, like, the less aware that you're how stupid you are. So
right.
I'm like, I hope I'm never that guy, man.
I think you're doing just fine. But before we go, let's tell folks where they can find your work. I know you have a lot of different projects. I want to make sure that I mention the Mac Nut Butter that just came out. I just tried that. My wife did too. It's so good. It's so good. So talk about your book. Where can people find you, your Mac Butter, and all the rest of it?
Right on. Well, they go visit me at bradkearns.com. You'll see all kinds of exciting videos. You can go click on the running technique one and up the numbers once again. You can see this fun nut butter project that I'm sharing with the world, and my MOFO mission, where I'm promoting the animal organ supplements that you and I love taking so much. And yeah, so I appreciate the opportunity to connect. I love the work you're doing. I've been a fan since day one of the Fat Burning Man podcast. I don't know when that was, like 2012 or some crazy archaic, you know, it was the only one in the fitness category. Now there's 17,000, but so I love our regular checkups, Abel. It's a pleasure.
Yeah, it's a great time to catch up, and I really appreciate your work, Brad. Thanks for coming on.
Take care, Abel. Keep it up.
Hey, it's Abel one last time, and I just want to say thank you for listening to this episode of Fat Burning Man. Before you go, please smash that like button, hit subscribe, or even leave us a quick review. It helps so much more than you even realize. And if you can think of someone else who you care about, friend, family member, anyone else who might appreciate this free show, then please take a quick second just to share it with them. Word of mouth is really the way that we've grown this show over the years. We have more than, at this point, 4 awards in independent media, 50 million downloads. We couldn't do any of this without you, so we really appreciate it. If you'd like to get in touch with me, then please follow me under Abel James or Fat Burning Man on your social media platform of choice, and I'll do my best to get right back to you. Now, if you want to keep this show coming to you, you can do something really quickly here. My wife Allison and I, along with a very small team, depend on listeners like you to make this show happen week after week. To join our next challenge, coaching group, or get in touch with me one-on-one, visit fatburningman.com. We also make group coaching free with your subscribe and save orders from our family company, Wild Superfoods, which you can find at wildsuperfoods.com. And if you'd like, you can throw a few bucks into the tip jar as a one-time donation, or become a contributing member of our group on Patreon. Just look up Abel James on Patreon, and you can join in the fun for as little as a few bucks and get my international best-selling book and audiobook as a special thanks. You can also find that page at fatburningman.com/tipjar. Now, a quick disclaimer for all those legal eagles out there. The Fat Burning Man Show provides general information and discussions about health and related subjects. The information provided in this show or in any related materials are not intended and should not be construed as medical advice, nor is the information a substitute for professional medical expertise, diagnosis, or treatment. The opinions and views expressed on this show have no relation to those of any academic, hospital, health practice, or other institution, including corporate overlords. We don't have any of those. If you or any other person has a medical concern, I wholeheartedly encourage you to consult with your healthcare provider. Whew! Okay. Don't forget to join our newsletter over at fatburningman.com. When you sign up for our email, I'll even send you a wild quick start guide along with a few of our ridiculously tasty recipes, even Allison's famous chocolate cookies, as a special thanks for signing up. This is Abel James signing off. Thank you so much for listening, and have a great week.